طيب، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Do you know how this work, Sheikh? So, inshallah, what page, yeah, Sheikh?
I have here marked on page 67.
The Aqeedah, right?
Yeah, methodology in a way.
Okay. Hey.
No battery.
No battery, okay, no problem. I think what we have is enough, inshallah. 67. طيب. الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We are, الحمد لله, praise Allah عز وجل for all the grace that He sustains in us, الحمد لله. And now we resume our regular class, inshallah. We change from Sundays to Mondays after we ask many brothers and they accept this. This day, because you have other class with Sheikh Fawaz on Sundays. Before we start, I would like just to remind myself and remind my brothers also about the importance of correcting our intention to be for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. Because whenever there is sincerity in the heart when we do anything, then Allah Azza wa Jal will bless our effort and benefit us from what we are doing. Sincerity is very, very important. Very important. Sincerity, in fact, it is the thing that raises the value of the deeds. It's not how much you do, but you know how sincere you did it. Well, you know, when you did it, this is a very, very important thing. Seeking knowledge is ibadah. Ibadah, I mean, it's an act of worship. In fact, one of the most high types of ibadah, because knowledge is the key to understand the Sharia. And you remember, and we always emphasize this, that Islam, you know, the religion of Allah Azza wa Jal, based on knowledge. This is why the first verses that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was read, you know, what knowledge importance. And the most, the thing that Allah Azza wa Jal commanded His Prophet Alayhi Salatu Wasallam to ask more of is knowledge. وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. Say, oh my Lord, increase me in knowledge. So if we correct our intention when we attend these classes or listen to class of knowledge, and we seek the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal, and we have the intention that we'll use this knowledge to please Allah Azza wa Jal, then Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will bless our time, our effort, and whatever knowledge that we got, and then we'll see the fruits of this knowledge in our life, not only in this world but in the hereafter, because Allah Azza wa Jal raised in high those, you know, who have more knowledge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us in the knowledge of deen. Now we start for our classes. As you know, we have two books. We are studying the book of fiqh and the book of aqidah. One book of fiqh and one aqidah. The book of Aqidah, now we have been talking about the many, many important points, which is understanding the Aqidah in the light of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salat wa sallam. This is a very important thing, especially at this time. As you know, there are many fitan. There are many fitans. There are many groups, and every one of them, he claims that he is following the Quran and the Sunnah. But the question is, how do they understand the Quran and the teaching of the Quran and the verses of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The only way is to understand the Quran in the light of the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam, the authentic Sunnah. And the most important thing also, to understand the Quran and the Sunnah in the light of the understanding of the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because they were the people who lived at the time of the revelation around the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. Therefore, their understanding for the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salam more accurate than anybody else. It is very, very important. And you remember when you talk last, you know, previous lesson about different group, especially like those Khawaris who try to explain or to use certain bases, I mean, verses in the Quran to support their claim, which is far away from the accurate understanding of the teaching of the Quran. And based on their, you know, wrong understanding, they deviated. And they caused the Ummah of many lost because of the way they act. And nowadays we can see some of these groups who are using, they are killing, they are making, terrify people, and then they think that what they are doing is, for the sake of Allah. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. So this is the misguidance of the shaitan. This is why we need to understand the Quran, the Quran and the teaching in the light of the main sources, in the understanding of the Sahaba of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and the first generation. The last class we studied, we talk about Aqidah versus philosophy. We compared what the difference between Aqidah and philosophy. And just to, before we proceed, I would like, to remind you of some important points that we said about this matter. First of all, we said that philosophy is man-made religions or beliefs based on the understanding of man, which is not perfect in all cases or all situations. So, to analyze, to conclude, to reach conclusion based on man analysis of what he is seeing or deal with. And we said not every type of knowledge could be achieved through man's senses. Why? Because there is certain type of knowledge which is beyond the capacity of the human mind to comprehend or to understand. As one example is the soul or the spirit. What is it? They asked the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and the Quran reported this. And why the Quran reported this question and the answer? To turn our attention that there's something beyond your understanding, and no matter how much you try it, you will not be able to understand it. This is why Allah Azza wa Jal said, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ. They ask you regarding the soul. Is there any answer here? Look at the answer. قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. Say, the ruh, the soul, is of the matter that only Allah knows. مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. And then, to emphasize this fact, Allah Azza wa Jal said, وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. And what you were given of knowledge, no matter how much that you think that it is, too much, still a little. Nothing besides the knowledge of Allah Azza wa Jal. So the Quran, you know, taught us when you come to a certain point, your intelligent, your mind cannot proceed but stop. And this is why, my dear brothers, the ulama of Islam, when they study psychology, they are the one who brought the psychology from the something that was not real to become real. Before, the Muslim scholars, philosophers at the time of the Greek, they were thinking, they trying to understand the soul. And they spent all their time just to try to explain this. And because the Muslims, they have this answer, they didn't, you know, waste any time to search in an area they know that they cannot get any knowledge about. So they turn to the behavior of people and how to understand their personalities of man through, you know, observing their behavior. This is why they call it a human behavior. And this, in fact, you know, the main or the foundation of the modern, you know, psychology, which is try to understand, analyze personality through observing the behavior and then make conclusion from this behavior. So here's just an example. So what we mean here, so when man try to understand or to analyze, you know, something which is of the unseen without using the real sources for this knowledge, then he will get what? Straight. This is why all these man-made religions or beliefs, you will find many contradictions, many confusion. Even the people who are followed, they reach a point they cannot explain it. They just say, they just accept it without understanding. While the Quran, the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, based on knowledge. Right. Last point we talk about, what's the difference? The difference in the purpose and the methodology. You see, both in a philosophy or philosophers and religion, they want to give man understanding or answering the most profound questions that everyone asks. Who am I? Where did I come from? Where I am heading? What's my goal in this world? What's my mission? What is my mission? Why I'm here? Religion try to explain this. Philosophers try to, but the only way to understand this, only through the one who founded and created this man. He is the one who will give the answer. This is, you know, in relate to the object. Now when the objective. Now when we talk about the methodology, also there is different. Because the methodology of religion, especially in Islam, we based on what? On sources which is related to the unseen, which is revelation. Because there's many things that we cannot understand, no matter how much we try, but through answer from someone who have a connection with the one who knows the unseen. Somebody who bring for us the teaching, okay, or answers from the one who created us. And this is the mission of all prophets and messengers of Allah sallallahu alayhim wa sallam jami'an. See? Look to the ayah in Surah Al-Kahf at the end. Allah Azza wa Jalla subhanahu wa ta'ala say, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ. Say, O Muhammad alayhi salam, say, tell the people, I'm not more than a man like yourself, like you, a man. basharun mithlukum. But what? Yuha ilay. Revelations come to me. So here, a man who's like us, but he was chosen by Allah Azza wa Jal to send revelation to him so he can transmit it to us. Then we understand why God created us. What's our history, background, where did we come from? We know that Allah Azza wa Jal created Adam and Eve, and then we came. Without this revelation, we cannot reach this fact. You see, people, when they start to think, you know, they try, you know, till they reach the point to say that man is just development of other creatures like apes or subhanallah. Here you have the answer. What's our mission? Here, people, they don't know. They want to please God, but they don't know what God wants from them. So what they do? They create from themselves a mission that Allah Azza wa Jalla did not command them to do it. And they make their own legislation, which instead of pleasing Allah Azza wa Jal, in fact, doesn't it displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like people who deviate. They took some people, they call them as son of God. Naam? Or like, you know, the deviated, like Christianity, or others who take different creations as gods, subhanallah. So the only way to know the true God is through revelation that come from God himself. And this is why Allah Azza wa Jalla, when he sent messenger, he provided him with many miracles to prove that he was chosen by Allah Azza wa Jalla to carry the message to people. So when people, they become, you know, convinced that this man, no doubt, he's a messenger of Allah, then they have no choice but to follow whatever he is telling them. This is why Allah Azza wa Jal sent the Quran down, and Prophet Muhammad alayhi wasalam, not only as a book of guidance, but as miracles, continuous miracles, that it's impossible for man to bring like this book and then challenge people to tell them that this is the book of Allah. If you think that this is not from Allah, then produce one chapter, just one chapter, like this book, subhanAllah. So the methodology is different here. So today, inshallah, this is what we talked about, origin and sources. And we read in the methodology and way, and then we'll, maybe today we'll continue all about Aqeedah, because we are late, and then inshallah, we'll start next week. طيب. So the philosophical methodology differ from its Islamic counterpart from the beginning to the end. There is different. They are not similar. Many philosophers begin by studying the human psycho, making this their basis and starting point. People, they start with the creation. Look at this. What they see. So when they speak of their understanding of the knowledge, they say that sometimes it is empirical, based on experiences. So only their knowledge based on what they experience. Experience they went through. Sometimes it is rational, based on reason, and sometimes it's both. So you see, this is the human knowledge. Either it is experience, either try to what we call it logic or rational analysis, and or both of them. They made the natural and other sciences the basis without which knowledge cannot be acquired. Then they claim that in this manner they could understand matters which were close to them in the realm of nature, mathematics, and ethics. They made these three the foundation on which all sciences are built. Man himself put his own rule in a universe which was not created by him. Subhanallah. Look at this. Thus they are also represented in the basis of ilm al-kalam. Ilm al-kalam, kalam in Arabic means what? Kalam. Ma fi kalam, you go. Talk. Science of talk. Just a matter of talk. Argument. Argument. And people, when they argue without basis, without foundations, may not reach any conclusion. They can talk and talk and talk for no end. Where it is said that one is half of two, the body cannot be in two places at once, and that two opposites, such as black and white, cannot be joined. You see, it's a matter of try to make it, you know, logic. They said, cannot, the body is one. How can you divide them? So the body cannot. Yes, something could confuse more than giving answers sometimes. And this is the way, my dear brothers, this is why we are telling brothers, don't try to get into philosophical argument, because they will confuse you. And more, this atheist, they depend on this methodology, this way, to confuse many believers. Why? Because the believers, the way is very easy and very clear in front of them. Okay? First of all, you know for sure that this man was sent by God. How? Examine his miracle. Can any man do like what he did? If what he did is beyond the ability of man, then that means this man was supported by miracles by God to show that he's a messenger of God. When you reach this conclusion, now you got the key to the source of knowledge. So whatever question that you have, he will give you the answer. But when you come to argument, and from question to other question, you know, sometimes you ask question, you want to get answer, instead of getting answer, you are getting what? More questions and more confusion. Many of these people do not consider ethical matters such as justice and chastity. Sometimes they don't look at this matter. Ethic and justice is not important. And this is why there are many of the theories that come, and mankind, they are suffering from these theories that destroy humanity. Why? Because sometimes they don't care about certain matters like the ethics of this creation being a part of basic principle. Rather, they see them as a minor issues for which support and evidence are required. All what they look only on what they think it is correct, without, and you know, try to understand or to have more or deep knowledge about these, you know, the ethic behind what they are doing. Many philosophical writers start with logic, then empirical sciences and mathematics, then they move knowledge of the divine. So they started from this world and try to understand the other world. As we mentioned, that it's not possible for man to understand anything about the other world. Why? Because this is what we call it, alam al-ghayb. Alam al-ghayb, the unseen. So this word, you know, the knowledge of either seen or unseen. Alam al-ghayb wa alam al-shahada. Seeing, this is what man can see, and people, wherever they are, they can experience, they can test, they can reach conclusion through their search, no problem. When you talk, for example, about natural phenomena, this is why people, my dear brothers, no matter what's their background, they are not different when you talk about this world. All people, they agree that the sun rises from where? From the east. Nobody will argue and say, no, no, it's from the north. All of them. And go in the west. People, they understand the circle of the moon. And this is why they can predict something of some phenomena in the natural life, what they call it, forecasting for weather. They tell you about these troubles sometimes that come, like hurricanes or which come. Why? Because they are studying. This is in the hand of people to study. But when we come to talk about paradise, about Jannah, about what's the attributes of God, then they come just about imagination. They have no solid start point to start with. And then this is why, my dear brothers, you see, when people, they talk about God, they are different. When they talk about the sun, the moon, anything of this world, they have no differences. When talk about God, some people, they say Jesus is God. Others, they say Buddha is God. People, they have more than God. Subhanallah. Why? Because here you're talking about something that you cannot see. And because you use your limited ability to learn about this matter or investigate about this matter, which cannot be achieved through this way, then people get confused. So how can we know about this? You cannot know anything about the unseen unless you have contact or channel that transmit information between from the unseen. This is why Allah Azza wa Jalla, my dear brothers, Allah Azza wa Jalla subhanahu wa ta'ala choose men not only in this ummah, but from the time Allah Azza wa Jalla created Adam and his offspring, they come to this world, Allah sent many messengers. What's the purpose? وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا نَفَعْبُدُ. Allah Azza wa Jal, in every nation, in every community, He sent, choose from them, from among men, choose a man, just person. He's most of the, or all the Anbiya, the prophets, they were chosen from the noble people of their community. Subhanallah. And then Allah Azza wa Jal revealed to him. So he is the one who will give the answer about God. He is one. This is the first command. And you find it even in previous religion. And then what's the attribute of this God? What does He want from us? Why He subhanahu wa ta'ala created us? So we get all the answer that philosophy or, all research methods that people use, in research or scientific research cannot reach, because this is the knowledge that only comes through revelation. And this is why my dear brother is a Muslim, alhamdulillah. He's in peace of mind. He's not confused. He knows who is God. He knows that God is one. He knows that God is powerful. He's the one who provides him. He's the one that he can depend on him. So he lives in peace of mind. Subhanallah. While the one who is lost, like the one who running, going around in the darkness, he come from one doubt to get to other doubt. Why? Because he's in darkness. And this, subhanallah, my brothers, if you notice the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal we never describe, talk about light and darkness, talk about light as one. Talk about dark, about darkness is many. الظلمات والنور. There is only one nur. Only one nur, one light. Because this is the way, straight. Because the straight or the fact is one. While the darkness, the misguided, there are many. They come from in different types, in different colors, in different methods, in different shapes, in different ways. So Allah Azza wa Jalla said, "Al-Zulumatu," not one dhulma, but dhulumat, more than one. One nur, only one nur. And this nur, and the real nur, the real light, is that which come from the Creator. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as nur. And described the Quran as nur. The Quran is light. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is light. Why called light? Because they show you the way. وَسِرَاجًا مُنِيرًا. Subhanallah. Ay, shining. This is the description of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. So, this is the difference here. طيب. Then they move to discuss. They come with a point to argue about, and then they try to make an argument. And then they never reach any conclusion. So people, when they listen to this, what they do, they get any answer? Or they are confused?
Confused.
And subhanAllah, let me just explain one point now. If you ask any of Christian, and many, you know, some of them, they are very faithful, you know, they think they are in the right path, and you would start to talk to them, what do you mean by God as one, while you are saying that that God, this is what they call it, the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. How come you say there are three, and then you said God in one? I talk about this with many different people. I didn't get the same answer. Everyone understand it in his own way. Why? Because it's confusing, it's like philosophy. And subhanAllah, by the way, that the Trinity is not only in Christianity. Trinity was brought to Christianity from atheists, from those man-made philosophies. So you'll find Trinity even in Hinduism, in many other ancient religions. Which does mean they borrow from each other. This is what the shaitan is doing. Confuse people about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about the qalb. طيب. So, to conclude this point, we say that philosophy cannot get you to the truth about God, about what the purpose of creation, about what the destiny of man. This is the conclusion. Question, why? Because philosophy using only human senses and a human rationale, which cannot reach or discover anything about the unseen. طيب, the only way for salvation is to understand who are you, why you are here, who created you, and you cannot get this answer unless you get the right knowledge from the one who created you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God, out of His mercy, He did not lift us without guidance. This is why Allah Azza wa Jalla, as we mentioned, He sent many prophets, many messengers. So people, they cannot say, oh God, we didn't know. لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ. So there is nobody can argue at the day of judgment and say, oh Allah, we didn't know. How can we know about you? You didn't send anybody for us. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, there is no excuse for you, because messengers came to you and books was revealed to you. But you are the one who didn't choose to follow the truth, and you are heedless about the revelation that came down to you or we sent to you. طيب. Most philosophers speak in depth about matters of nature or instance. They then discuss the stars and planets. Then those among them who study the matter of divinity start to speak about one who must exist and about reason and the human nature. Some of them try to prove the existence of the one who must exist on the basis that this universe has to have the one who must exist. Human nature, you know, the natural or rationality of man, even in the logic, it will tell you that behind anything which exists, there are someone who made it. Nobody can argue, you know, tell you, for example, like this bottle just came by itself. This is the argument of the Darwinism now. They try to tell you this. But strange that when you talk about very simple matter, this wire, did this wire come by itself? If you ask anybody, it's impossible. This should be made by somebody who knows how to make it. Right or not? Okay, if you believe about this very tiny things, that there's one or a man or somebody who made it, how about this planet, the stars, human being himself, this well-organized system, subhanallah, it's impossible just come by itself. So some of the professors, they try to reach this and they say, okay, we think there is what they call it, super mind. Sometimes they call it different names. This is the point, it's different. Maybe they reach the conclusion that there is creator, because this is the logic. But then who is he? And then they turn to you and they say, Mother Nature. Subhanallah. Or they turn, they give different. Yani, subhanallah. So when man try to understand something that he cannot see, he just give imagination. No one saw angel because of from the unseen. Now how do we know? All in the literature, on pictures, in kids, even in movies, how do they show angels? They show them with wings. Two wings and some in there, subhanallah. Did you see any? Say no. But this what people, they heard, imagine, and they took it this way. For sure there are something of what we call it part of the truth. Allah Azza wa Jal revealed to previous prophets something about the angels. Allah Azza wa Jal said about angels, they have wings. But when people, they imagine these wings, it's like a bird. Subhanallah, while the wing of one, just one of the angel may cover the whole world, like Jibril alayhi salam. Subhanallah, Jibril alayhi salam, he said when he opened his wing, he covered the horizon. Subhanallah. So they give their own imagination. So, and about reason and the human nature, Some of them try to prove the existence of the one on the basis that this universe has to have the one who must exist. طيب. The aim of those scholars of ilm al-kalam who affirm tawheed in their books is to prove the oneness of Creator and that he has no partner or asset. They think that this is what is mean by phrase la ilaha illallah. So some, this is the problem of this ilm al-kalam philosophers, and they just, you know, it depends on argument. They want to prove everything in the religion using the logic approach. He said, yes, we believe in la ilaha illallah, but they try to prove it their own way. Sometimes, for example, if we said, okay, they reach the same conclusion about the oneness of God, see, but we reach the same thing, that God is one. Okay, this has come with human nature. But when you go in depth about who is this God, huh? What is his attribute? Then comes the confusion. And this is why, my dear brothers, when it's come to al-asma wa sifat, the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal, you will find the argument. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبْسُوطَتَانِ بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبْسُوطَتَانِ, about that his two hands, they said, Allah said that he has hands. But then they come, they said, but how can you give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the description which was man? So they try to, what they do, twist the meaning of hands. That's mean, they will tell you, that's mean hand, that's mean his power. Or they give other meaning. This is the problem, my dear brothers, when people, they follow this argument. So how can we understand the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal? Through what? The only way is through the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is why my Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, you know, those who are following the truth, the true path, when they talk about the attribute, they take it only from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah Azza wa Jal said that he has a face, he has hands. We believe that he has a face and has hands. How? No question about it. It's not similar to anything, because Allah Azza wa Jal said, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There's nothing looks like him. You see the guideline here? But if it was left for man, then he will start what? His own imagination. And this is what you see, my dear brothers, in movies. Movies. Now, when they talk about God, or about angels, about, they are their own imagination, which is far away from the truth. Yes, this is different. Right. So even as we said, ilm al-kalam at the beginning may give you one piece of the truth, that doesn't mean they have the whole truth. But then they will get confused. This is why the Muslim, my dear brothers, always, once come to a matter of religion, he stick to what? To pure sources, which is a pure revelation that come through the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salam. This methodology of philosophy and ilm al-kalam keep the researcher busy for a lifetime without ever reaching any conclusion. This is the point here. Argument and argument and argument. And because of this argument, what will happen? They will divide it to what? Scatter to what? Many groups. And this is what you see it. Now, those, if you look, subhanAllah, to people who deviated from the true path, the Quran and the Sunnah, how many they are? Every day it's come subgroup and subgroup and subgroup. Look how many sects they come. Because whenever they come together, they will keep argument, and some of them, they will not agree, they will start a new way, a new deviation. And this explains to you the existence of the many groups who went astray, deviated from the straight path. وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا. Look at the Quran expression here. وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا. Wait for that. So look at the now, we explain, maybe we talk a little bit in detail about the way and the methodology of those philosophers. And we say they started from what they see, and from man, from what. But the Quran, the revelation, start to tell you first of all about the one who created you. Subhanallah. Now, two examples I'll give you. First of all, the first five verses, which was repeated to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, explain this. قال عز وجل, اقرأ, read, بسم ربك الذي خلق. Look, first thing is read. With what? The name of your Lord. And then he's telling you and explaining to you that your Lord is the one who creates. And this, my dear brother, is very, very short word that to tell you that the real God is the one who creates, the creator. خلق الإنسان من علق. And then tell you about your origin. اقرأ, again, read, بسمي, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق, خلق الإنسان من علق, اقرأ وربك الأكرم. Read, and then remember the your generous Lord الذي خلق الإنسان, اقرأ وربك الذي علم الإنسان, and then علم بالقلم, taught man. So he talk about Allah, and then he tell you what's your relation to Allah, that you are creation of Allah, and then tell you that the source of knowledge to understand yourself is the knowledge that come from Allah, because he is the one who created you, and he's the one who taught you. عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ. عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمْ عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ. Taught man things that he never knew. So this is the way. So the Quranic or the revelation start by emphasizing the importance, first of all, to know who is your Lord. In Surah Al-Baqarah, the first call, and when said call, there's many calls in the Quran. Ya ayyuha, O you. Either call for mankind, Ya ayyuha al-Nas, or call for the Prophet, or call for the believers, Ya ayyuha al-Ladina aman, or call for the disbeliever. So the first call that's come in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, also to emphasize this fact. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, Ya ayyuha al-Nas, O mankind, u'budu rabbakum. U'budu rabbakum. Worship your Lord. The first call. And then he's telling, who is this Lord? Ya ayyuha al-Nas, u'budu rabbakum. Alladhi khalaqakum wal-ladhina min qablikum. Worship your Lord. Who is he? The one who created you. This is your Lord. This is your Lord, who created you and created people who come ahead of you, before you. So this is the point here. So the Quran started, first of all, the first thing that man should know who is the one who created him. This is why Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعَبُدُوا. This is the first command. And we did not send any messenger before you, but we revealed to him, saying, none has the right to be worshipped but Allah Azza wa Jal. So worship me. So worship me. So this is the meaning of La ilaha illa. La ilaha illa ana fa'abudu. Every messenger come, every messenger, all messengers, the first thing they tell their people, know that there is only one God, and then you should what? Worship him alone. Right. Every messenger first of all asks his people to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya qawm i'budu Allah ma lakum min ilahin ghayru. The same message repeated by all messengers. If you read the Quran, this ayah, it was said by many prophets. Ya qawmi, i'budu Allah. Oh my people, worship Allah. You have no other God but him. So he asked them to worship Allah Azza wa Jal with their hearts, their tongue, and their physical facility. This is the meaning of belief, of faith. Faith is not only word by the tongue. Not only just something that you feel. ولكن إيش الإيمان ما وقر الصدر. This is what is in the heart. Expressed by your word. They said, La ilaha illallah. This is why when somebody come and said, I want to be a Muslim. First of all, he will be asked, are you convinced? Is this from your heart? You think that this is the truth? Or are you just following, you know, or imitating some people? No, I am certain about this. Okay, then you express this. And then it should be what? Huh? You should practice and live your life according to this belief. So, three. Start in the heart. Huh? And then it should be expressed by our sayings. And it should be done by our action. This is the real meaning of belief. Because you'll find some people, they say, we believe in God. Okay, you believe in God, what? Oh, I believe that he exists. I believe that he provided me. This will not benefit you. Okay. Or he said, and then when he talk, he says something which is contradict with that. This is what we call it shirk. So whenever he said, I believe in God, but then he said, but Ali, okay, can help me in this, or he know the future, or that's mean you, even you say believe in God, but your belief, which was expressed by your word, show that your belief is not the same true belief that should be na'am, understood from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Or somebody said, Al-Iman fil qalb. Now some people, when he said, my brother, why didn't pray? He said, I'm Muslim, alhamdulillah. Why you didn't pray? He said, no. Faith is in the heart. Halas, Allah knows that I am a believer. If you are truly believer, then the fruit of this belief, it will be shown in your action. It should be expressed through your action. Right. So according to this methodology, as the Sheikh said here, so he asked them to worship Allah, as we mentioned. According to this methodology, the foundation of knowledge is knowledge of Allah. For Allah is the first who created all that exists and the last. He's the first because nothing before him. Allah Azza wa Jal was there without beginning. And everything come later because he's the one who created them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will last after everything gone. This is what we call it, هو الأول والآخر. He's the first without beginning and he's the last without end. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you start from this knowledge, that you know that the first thing that you know, the one who created you. And then you should understand that your return will be to him. So if you know this, what's the implication of this in your life? Then since he is the one, and then I will return to him, then I should make sure that I do whatever he wants from me. Why? Because if I say that I return to him, that means he will judge me. He will question me. Therefore, I should do, act, say whatever please him subhanahu wa ta'ala when I return to him. So he is the all-encompassing principle. Knowledge of him is the basis of knowledge. Remembrance of him is the basis of all remembrance. And striving for his sake is the basis of all effort. Everything that we do in our life should start from Allah and return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why, my dear brother, this is the understanding of the Muslim. So the Muslim now, when he eats food or drink water, why is he eating? This, you know, the philosopher that said, ask this question. Do we eat to live or live to eat? Look at this question. Philosophical question. They ask this. Do we live to eat or we eat to live? Which one? They think, wow, this is a very difficult question. How can you answer this? This is confusing for everybody except Muslim. Because the Muslims tell you what? We eat to live, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the purpose of my drinking is not just to build this body, but to build it, to do its duty toward the one who created it. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. This, my dear brothers, the Muslim, subhanallah, is rewarded for everything if he recalls the intention. قَالَ عَزَمْ إِنِّي لَأَحْتَسِبُ عَلَى اللَّهِ قَوْمَتِي وَنَوْمَتِي. I always recall the intention that whenever I am awake or I am asleep, I make all this for the sake of Allah. So when you go to bed early and said, oh Allah, in your heart, you don't need to say it by your word, because Allah knows it. But you recall that you are sleeping to get rest. So you will, you know, start, resume your life after